Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hanging Mary by Susan Higginbotham, narrated by Johanna Parker. Part 1.
I wish you knew, Ma. I know you would like her.
John Surratt, writing to his cousin.
This young woman is a plain, unassuming girl.
W.P. Wood, Superintendent, Old Capitol Prison. 1. Mary Surratt, August 1864.
There were two things for which I could thank my late husband, buying our house in Washington and dying. It was in 1862 when my husband left this world, but 2 years later I still woke sometimes, trembling, before I remembered I was perfectly free. No more drunken rages to endure. No more finding my husband face down on the floorboards. No cuffs to the head, which, to John's credit, did not come that often, but of which I always lived in dread. I could lie in bed and stretch out comfortably, knowing no brute was going to soil the sheets or violate my body. A drunken man is seldom careful with his money, and John was no exception. Though he was fairly prosperous when I married him, it was, I must admit, one of his attractions. He made bad decisions, the worst of which was to build the tavern and bar I continued to run after his death. How I hated the place! It brought John to his ruin, I sincerely believed, because as a naturally taciturn man, he had to drink harder than ever to make himself jovial to his customers. Worst, it left him in debt, which I still owed, his parting gift to me. For 2 years, my children and I struggled to maintain this folly of his, and with the prospect that Maryland would soon adopt a new constitution that would free our three slaves, we could expect only to struggle harder. But John made one investment that brought in a steady income, a handsome house on H Street in Washington, about 15 miles from this sleepy crossroads in southern Maryland. For years, it had been rented to a reliable tenant, until, one sweltering August day, I received a letter. Poor health was obliging my tenant to move to the country, and he would not be renewing the lease. So, atop of everything else, we would have to find a new tenant, one who might or might not be dependable. Bad news. Until I sat back and pondered the situation more thoroughly. This was my chance to start a new life. The tenant in Washington is not renewing his lease, I told my son and my daughter as we sat down to our dinner that evening. After praying about the matter, I have come up with an idea I hope will suit us all. Instead of leasing our house in Washington, we move into it ourselves. If we lease this place and take in boarders at H Street, we can live much less expensively than we are living now, and we can pay off some of those wretched debts. Boarders? Anna wrinkled her nose. We must, my dear. Even if we did not need the income, it would be foolish to waste all of that space. And what is wrong with taking in a few quiet, well-behaved people in the city when we already take our chances with anyone who passes through here?
That is a point. And there will be shops and concerts and the theater. I like the idea, Ma.
And we can walk to church as well. You, Johnny?
Suits me fine. And I might even have a boarder for us. My friend, Mr. Weichman. He's got a government job now, so he can pay. And I know he's not happy with his present lodgings. Too far from his job and too large and lonely, he says.
Johnny looked sidelong at his older sister.
And no pretty girls.
Johnny, if he is to come live with us, you mustn't encourage that sort of thing. I won't abide it. But when can we move, Ma? I will need a new dress for the theater. It won't do to walk around in rags, or we will never attract a good class of boarder.
Don't pack yet, child. We must first lease this place. And we have to get the Washington house fixed up as well. In truth, I was scarcely less excited than Anna, and was already settling in my mind which furniture to take to Washington and which to leave here. The last of the evening tipplers had waved away from the bar, and Anna had gone to bed, when Johnny knocked at my door.
"Ma, you're gonna rent the place to someone on our side, aren't you?"
"Most certainly. War is men's business, I had always believed. But on the day Lincoln was inaugurated, my oldest son, Isaac, rushed off to Texas and later joined the Confederate Army, so it drew me in. It drew me in another way as well. My husband, who, like most people in this part of southern Maryland, sympathized with the South, allowed the tavern to become a stop for those making the dangerous journey across the Potomac River into Virginia, running the blockade between North and South with goods, mail, and money. I had no choice in the matter, of course, but had I been consulted, I no doubt would have agreed. How could I do otherwise, with a son fighting for the Confederacy? So, after my husband died, I saw no reason to alter the tavern's status as a safe haven, especially as my Johnny had been aiding the Confederacy too, since he left school after my husband's death, first by using the post office in our tavern as a drop for those wishing to send mail to the South, then, once the Union took his postmaster position away from him for disloyalty, as a courier himself. "I have been thinking, Johnny, that a tenant may not be necessary, should you want to run the place on your own." Johnny shook his head.
"I'm tired of peeling drunks off the floor, Ma, and I can serve the Confederacy a lot better if I don't have this place to worry about."
"No. As a matter of fact, I was thinking when I was tending bar tonight that I know a man who might be perfect, a Mr. Lloyd. He's in Washington now, but he stops here whenever business brings him through Prince George's County. And I know he's been hankering for a country life, if he can find something to do."
"And he is a Southern man?"
"Yes, and even better, he's a man who minds his own business."
2. Nora, August 1864 to October 1864.
"I don't like my present lodgings, Father." My father looked around at my room, which was large and comfortably furnished. It was not cool. No place could be so in Washington City in late August. But a shade tree rendered it at least tolerable.
"Why not, child? The Mrs. Donovan are sweet ladies."
"They are sweet old ladies. We do nothing besides drink tea and go to mass. If I go outside, I have to go with their servant, Clarence, and he is almost as old a lady as they are."
"Child."
"Well, it is true."
"Miss Nora, the missus won't like you going on this street. There is a saloon here."
"There's a saloon on every street in Washington, Father. I might as well be a prisoner."
"Surely you exaggerate, my dear."
"There's nothing to read here either."
"Why, they have a library full of books."
"Dreary books, dull books. Nothing but essays and history and religious works, because the missus consider novels unsuitable reading for impressionable young ladies." I frowned. "Well, that's not entirely true. They do have Clarissa, which I have read twice. It's very sad."
"What about the piano? Don't they let you play upon it?"
"Yes, but it's out of tune. They can't hear it well enough to know the difference. When I asked them if they could engage a tuner, they acted as if I were trying to turn the place into the Canterbury Music Hall." I sighed theatrically. "I might as well enter a convent, Father. This dreariness is insupportable." My father sighed as well. My mother had died when I was quite small, and my father, having loved my mother dearly and not caring to remarry, had sent me away for my education. The schools I attended were not the sort of places depicted by Mr. Dickens or Miss Charlotte Bronte, whose novels I devoured, but well-run, quiet establishments, where I learned to write an elegant hand, play the piano, and speak tolerable French. In such a manner, I had passed a happy, if somewhat monotonous, existence in tranquil surroundings until this June, when, at age 19, I had reached the point where there was very little that could be taught to me, or so I thought, and so I came home. Father was a messenger and a collector for the Metropolitan Bank, and had been so for decades. He had once left his position due to ill health, but his superiors missed him so sorely, and he missed them so sorely, that they begged him to resume his duties, which he did, with a rise in salary as his reward. He probably could have afforded to lease a small house, with me keeping it, when I left school, but he worked long hours, and sometimes had to go out of town on business, and Washington City was not the quiet town it had been when he came there in the 1830s. The war had brought in people from everywhere and every walk of life, and Father feared that, home alone, I might fall into unsuitable company. So he had placed me to board with the Mrs. Donovan, just a few blocks away from his own lodgings.
"You are truly unhappy here, child."
"I do like the ladies, Father," I replied truthfully. "But they are old maids, and if I stay here much longer, I will turn into one myself. I can just feel myself growing old here."
"I will consult with Peter, then. Perhaps he will know of a suitable lodging."
I suppressed a groan. There were two sorts of men my father admired, learned men and men of religion. And my older brother, Peter, an aspiring priest who had taken a teaching job at the soon-to-be-opened Boston College, had the happy distinction of falling into both categories. For the past few years, Father had been in the habit of consulting him about any business involving the family, which, since my older sister Hannah was a cloistered nun, generally meant my business. As Peter had often told Father that I was overindulged, I could imagine only with the greatest trepidation what sort of lodging, short of a convent, he would consider suitable. It was true that he had no more than a charity school education, and that he felt this keenly, but he could read anything put in front of him, and wrote a beautiful hand. He could add and subtract long figures in his head, while others, Peter included, were scratching their pens on papers and frowning over their errors. Weeks passed, and I was resigning myself to staying with the Mrs. Donovan and getting used to their untuned piano when, in late September, Father came to see me again, this time with Peter, come all the way from Boston to see to my affairs, at his side.
"Peter has found an ideal situation for you, Nora. A widow, Mrs. Surratt, is moving to Washington from the country and will be taking in boarders at her house on H Street. She's a very respectable lady."
A respectable widow sounded to me a little better than an old maid, but I nodded politely.
"She's been keeping a tavern and bar in Surrattsville, in Prince George's County in Maryland," my brother informed my father.
I noticed Peter was prematurely balding, unlike Father, who at age 64 still had a full head of gray hair.
"A bar?"
Father, who had never been a drinking man, frowned.
"Her husband ran the bar, and it was necessary for her to continue with that line of business in order to live. She has long wished to give it up, she told Father Ouijet, and move to Washington, but it was not until recently, when the tenant here failed to renew his lease, that this became a realistic possibility."
My father's expression lightened.
"She knows Father Ouijet, then?"
As well as being the priest of St. Aloysius, he was the president of Gonzaga College, where Peter had been both a pupil and a teacher.
"Yes, she has known him for many years, and her sons were at his school of St. Thomas Manor before it closed."
I perked up. Mrs. Surratt had sons?
"She has had a difficult life, Father Ouijet tells me. Her husband was adopted by a family of substance and inherited a handsome estate. But he was a poor businessman and a heavy drinker and squandered much of his holdings, and the war did the rest. They have only the tavern and the house in Washington."
My brother glanced at me.
Nora, I have spoken rather freely. I hope that if you do go to live with Mrs. Surratt, you will treat what I have said as matters of confidence.
Yes, I said. In truth, I had been too busy wondering about Mrs. Surratt's sons, 2, 3, more, handsome, to care about her difficult life.
Are her sons much about the house?
Father asked.
The elder is serving with the Confederate army, coming from where they do, that is to be expected, though, and the younger helps his mother with her affairs. Father Ouijet sees the younger one occasionally, when business takes him to Washington, and knows him to be of good character. But what makes this situation ideal, and I believe more congenial for Nora than her present one, is that Mrs. Surratt has a daughter, an accomplished young lady of 21. She will, therefore, have a suitable companion.
It sounds ideal, said Father. I knew that you would come up with something.
Peter nodded modestly.
Of course, I must meet this lady and satisfy myself that Nora will be safe in her care, but I am sure that is merely a formality. Is she living here now?
No, her business necessitates her staying in Surrattsville for a while longer, but her daughter will be moving here to set up the house.
Then, if Nora is agreeable?
I nodded.
We will drive over there on Saturday afternoon and introduce ourselves.
2 days later, we made our trip to the country. Father, who did not keep his own equipment, had rented a rather smart buggy for the occasion. It was a beautiful September day, neither too hot nor too chilly, and I felt very pleased with myself as, clad in my newest striped gown and the brand new bonnet I had convinced Father I needed for the occasion, I settled into the buggy. Still, I could not help wishing I had a fine young suitor beside me instead of my father. We drove through the streets of Washington to the Navy Yard Bridge, after which we passed into the countryside.
Let me give you the advice I have always given your child. Speak little about the war in these parts, anywhere really, but especially in these parts. Feeling is very strong here against the Union.
I know that, Father.
A reminder can't go amiss.
Although the war had been raging for over 3 years, I had never succeeded in finding out my father's true sympathies. So diligently did he follow the rule he had set for himself and me. I had come to suspect he, in fact, had no sympathy for either side, that his allegiance lay solely with Washington City, where he arrived over 25 years ago as a poor Irishman, and where he had married, fathered 6 children, and buried my mother and my 3 baby sisters. His work brought him into every street and alleyway of the city. There was simply no address he could not find. If a building had been torn down over the past 2 decades, he could tell you where it had stood and what had replaced it. Few people in the city did not know him, at least by sight, and there had to be a truly raging snowstorm to keep him from performing his duties. His affection for the city extended even to its miserable summer heat, in which he took an almost proprietary pride. In good time, we arrived at the crossroads of Surrattsville, so named because the Surratts had once operated the local post office out of their tavern, which, along with its outbuildings, was the only habitation I could see in the immediate vicinity. Being accustomed to town life, I understood why the family was so eager to leave this quiet place. As a colored servant took charge of our horse and buggy, Mrs. Surratt came outside to greet us.
"This is the young lady Father Ouijet recommended to me."
"Yes, ma'am. This is my daughter, Miss Honora Fitzpatrick. We call her Nora."
I stood by silently as my father and Mrs. Surratt eyed each other. It was clear they each approved. Clad in gray half-mourning, Mrs. Surratt looked to be in her early 40s. She was tall, with dark brown hair, and her figure was of substantial, though not fat, proportions. As for my father, with his gray hair and his erect figure, and with his faint Irish lilt, his presence was a courtly one.
Had he not been aghast at the idea of replacing my late mother, he could have remarried 6 times over.
Father explained to Mrs. Surratt what a modest and innocent young woman I was. Presumably, I suppose, to assure her that I would not be attempting to sneak men into the house or to do any of the other untoward things that more adventurous boarders than I evidently managed. It was all quite true. I was modest and innocent. But he made me sound like such a dull creature, it was disheartening to hear it all. Fortunately, there was not much to say about this subject, and the conversation soon turned to Mrs. Surratt, who assured Father that her boarding house would be a perfect repository for my virtue. Only well-behaved young men would be allowed to board. Anyone with liquor in his rooms would be turned out immediately, and I would be sharing a room with either Mrs. Surratt herself or her daughter, Anna, an equally respectable and virtuous creature, depending on how many boarders were in residence. It went without saying that I would be expected to attend Mass with the family regularly. As a matter of fact, Mrs. Surratt stated, the ease of walking to church from the H Street house had been one of the chief advantages of removing to the city. Soon, my father and Mrs. Surratt were discussing terms. The price, $35 per month, seemed reasonable to me, although my existence had been too sheltered for me to be much cognizant of such things. After Father expressed his satisfaction with the terms, Mrs. Surratt turned to me with a smile. The bargain needs only your consent, Miss Fitzpatrick. Would you like to stay in my house? Yes, I said without hesitation. Mrs. Surratt and I had barely exchanged 2 words, but I liked her face, and I liked the fact that she had put the final decision in my hands. So, 2 weeks later, after Miss Surratt, who had been visiting friends in Baltimore on the day I met her mother, removed to the Washington house, I walked to my new lodgings, having shamefacedly bade goodbye to the Mrs. Donovan, who sobbed over me like they would a beloved granddaughter. To heap further guilt upon my shoulders, they would not hear of my paying someone to carry my trunk for me, but sent Clarence with me to push it in a wheelbarrow.
Them poor old ladies will miss you awfully, Miss Nora, he said as he puffed along at my side. They thought the whole world of you.
I shifted the cat basket I held from arm to arm as a faint hissing emitted from it. I will miss them too, Clarence, but I wanted a companion of my own age, and I promised them that I would come over for tea once a week.
I do hope so, Miss Nora. It'll break their poor old hearts not to see you again. Old ladies getting up there, they set a lot of store by such things, you know. Why, they was going to buy you a nice little cake for your birthday.
My 20th birthday was a few days away. I'll visit next week, I promise. I had issued several such assurances by the time we arrived at our destination, a gray brick house on H Street between 6th and 7th. It was tidy and well-kept, though not as nice as that of the Mrs. Donovan, who took boarders more for the company than because of any actual need. Clarence could not resist a derisory sniff as he walked up the steps and knocked at the door leading to the parlor story of the house. An auburn-haired young lady, tall like Mrs. Surratt, but otherwise not bearing a strong family resemblance to her, answered. Miss Fitzpatrick, I suppose? Bring your trunk in here. This is where we will be sleeping for now. Clarence carried my trunk down the hall to a large bedroom at the back of the house. It was sparely furnished, with a view of the alley, and I could not help but compare it to my comfortable, chintz-filled quarters at the Mrs. Donovan's home. It will be nicer once I buy a few more things, Miss Surratt assured me. I have but just come to town and brought only what was absolutely necessary from the country. She looked ruefully out the window. Nothing to be done about the alley, I fear. Of course, I said. I turned to say my goodbye to Clarence, who clearly shared my misgivings about my new quarters. Thank you, and I will visit in a few days, I promise.
We'll all be looking for you, Miss Nora.
He bent close to my ear.
Don't forget, there's always a home for you with the ladies.
What did he say? Miss Surratt asked, as Clarence shut the door behind him. Oh, he just wished me well. An indignant mew came from my basket.
I see you've brought a cat.
Your mother said he would be fine. I set the basket down and opened it. Mr. Rochester leaped out, glaring at his new surroundings.
Oh, yes, we could use a mouser. Come into the parlor.
Our bedroom opened into that room, which Mr. Rochester had already found, as he perched by a window and surveyed H Street, his tail flipping majestically. I asked Miss Surratt, are there any other boarders here?
Not yet. Mr. Wackman, a dreadful friend of my brother's, will be coming, I think, and Ma wants to put a family with him on the third floor, so there's no point in us staying up there and then having to move out. There are bedrooms up in the attic where we can sleep once Ma comes, if there's space.
I nodded amicably. For years of boarding, at schools and in homes, had made me flexible. I'm sure it will suit.
You don't have an accent.
Should I?
Well, you're Irish. Didn't your family come here because of the famine? But of course, you must have been a little child at the time.
I shook my head. I was born right here in Washington City. Father has been in America since the 20s. He helped some of his kinsmen leave during the famine, though.
Where does your father live? Swamp Poodle?
She spoke of Washington's crowded and poor Irish neighborhood. I stiffened.
Certainly not, I said. Father boards on 12th Street. I don't know anyone who lives in Swamp Poodle, nor would I care to.
Well, you needn't get your get annoyed, I mean.
I am sorry.
As this sounded sincere enough, and I was going to have to share a bed with her, I nodded and began to put my things away in the drawer Miss Surratt indicated. I noticed with pleasure that my clothing was as good a quality as hers, if not better. As Father had always lived well within his means and was no longer charged with the keep of my brother or my sister, he gave me a generous allowance. To change the subject, I said,
"Your mother mentioned your brothers. Will they be living here?"
My younger brother, John, comes and goes from our house in Surrattsville. You'll meet him soon, I imagine. She gave me a look. My older brother, Isaac, is fighting for the Confederacy.
God keep him safe, I said politely.
Which side are you on? Though I inclined toward the north, I remembered my father's advice.
I have friends and family caught up on both sides, I said vaguely. I just hope it ends soon.
Do you have a sweetheart? This was ostensibly a safer topic than Swamp Poodle or the war, but it was a rather irritating one.
No,
I admitted. The truth was, like Jane Eyre, I was plain and little, and Washington City was woefully short of Mr. Rochester's in human form. I'd never had a beau. Nor had I even had a young man give me more than a passing glance.
And you?
I thought I had one, but he is serving as a doctor in Richmond. You can imagine, with all the young ladies acting as nurses, and all of them and their mothers inviting him to dine, there's not much time for me.
You're very pretty. I'm sure you're well rid of the faithless wretch.
Why, thank you. Miss Surratt held out her hand.
Call me Anna, Miss Fitzpatrick.
And you may call me Nora, not Honora. Only the nuns at school called me Honora.
It's good to have someone else in the house, Nora. We have some distant relations. Mr. and Mrs. Kirby live in just a few blocks from here. But he's busy with his work, and she's busy with her children, so they're not very diverting. I've hardly had a chance to see the city.
I'll show it to you. We're close to everything. The shops, the theaters. We're just blocks from Ford's Theater. I've been there several times.
I've never been there, Anna admitted. It's a lovely theater. We must go together.
I could not resist what I said next.
Why, I saw John Wilkes Booth play there.
Anna stared at me.
Him?
If you had put a young lady from New Orleans, a young lady from Boston, a young lady from Richmond, a young lady from Cleveland, a young lady from Baltimore, and a young lady from Washington together, the one thing they would have agreed upon, before they scratched one another's eyes out, was that John Wilkes Booth was one of the handsomest men in America. Any woman worthy of her sex, and I was no exception, could rhapsodize for hours upon his curling black hair, his soulful black eyes, his beautiful skin, and his fine physique. Even those women who hadn't actually had the privilege of seeing him in person. I was indeed among the lucky ones. For the previous year, he had played at Ford's Theater, and since I had been at school in Georgetown at the time, I had plagued my father until he agreed to take me. As the play had been Richard III, Mr. Booth's looks had not shone to their best advantage, since he was forced by the role to assume a hunchback and to scowl a great deal. Even so, I had had to repress a smile when Lady Anne informed Richard that he was a foul toad. I had gone to bed that night, thoroughly convinced such a lovely man could not possibly have killed his nephews, although, of course, the play said he did. Just the memory made me sigh. I did see him, and he was wonderful. Did you know that he now spends much of his time in Washington? We might get a glimpse of him in the street sometime. Anna's eyes widened. That, she breathed, would be absolutely divine. 3. Mary. October to November, 1864. Anna writes that she and Miss Fitzpatrick are having a splendid time furnishing the house, I told my son, waving a letter on top of a stack handed to me by Mr. Roby, our pro-union neighbor, who replaced Johnny when he was removed as postmaster, and who seemed perpetually disappointed he had not yet detected any suspicious correspondence coming to our house. I do hope that she is being prudent. Miss Fitzpatrick seems a sweet young woman, but it's plain that she's her old father's darling, and she didn't look the sort to economize. Is she pretty, Miss Fitzpatrick? She's pleasant-looking. That faint praise says volumes, Ma. She has a pretty figure, a great quantity of dark brown hair, and nice brown eyes. Johnny shrugged and wrapped his blanket more tightly around him. The previous month, he'd fallen deathly ill with influenza, and for a while I feared I would lose him, the son who had always been the closest to me. He was delirious for 2 terrible long days, and I sat beside him and mopped his forehead and listened to him rave. Touchingly, he ranted not about the war or about his courier activities, but about a young lady from the neighborhood, on whom, completely unbeknownst to me, he had set his heart before she went off to stay with relatives elsewhere. It broke my heart to see my boy's own heart broken. But when he came to himself, he would say nothing about the young lady, save to grudgingly admit she might have done well enough for him. Just a few days later, before he should have, he set off for Washington on one of the journeys about which he said so little, and when he returned, he promptly had a relapse and had to take to his bed again. But he was well enough now for us to discuss things that needed to be discussed, which did not happen to be Miss Fitzpatrick's looks. Johnny, when you are well, you must find some sort of work. You barely escaped the draft this time.
Don't I know it? But I could still get drafted, even if I had work.
Yes, but you could buy yourself out of it. But it is more than that. You need something steady.
I'm hardly idling, Ma. Were it not for this illness, I would not be sitting here. I'd be carrying messages.
And not earning a cent from it.
Only perhaps the thanks of a grateful nation someday.
That's commendable, but it's not putting bread on the table. And it's putting your very life in danger. I touched him on the shoulder. Johnny had never carried any extra weight on him, and now he felt painfully bony. Isaac could be dead for all I know, and last month I feared I'd lost you as well.
They've never come close to catching me, Ma, and if they did, It'd be a spell of imprisonment, that's all. Most likely.
This addendum did not fill me with confidence.
It's important work, Ma. I can't just walk away from it. And if I did, I would fall under suspicion from the people I've been helping. Then where would I be?
There was enough sense in this to make me sigh.
Anyway, maybe the election will make this all moot.
You know full well there's not much hope of that. McClellan doesn't stand a chance since Atlanta fell.
A man can dream.
My son shook the blanket off his shoulders and rose.
I'm going out.
Where? You are no fit state to travel.
I'll not go far. I just need to get out of here.
And away from my nagging, I thought guiltily. But Johnny, with his naturally kind temperament, would never dream of saying so. Johnny went only to Washington and returned in 2 days, looking healthier and bearing good news. Mr. Weichman had decided to board with us and would be moving in on the 1st of November. The girls, with the house to themselves, had been acting like a pair of society ladies, looking up all of their old schoolmates in the area, of which Miss Fitzpatrick in particular seemed to have an abundance, and inviting a different set over for afternoon tea each day. They had found a used pianoforte at a reasonable price, and it now graced the front parlor. Johnny assured me they had not beggared us, however, and Mr. Weichman, who came by to look at his prospective lodgings, found them very homey and appealing. Johnny had made a few inquiries about employment, preferably a job where he could combine the commercial and the clandestine, as he put it. I did not know how easy it would be to come by such a situation, but at least he was making an effort. And as we had a small farm, along with the tavern, and had to attend to the crop there, it was just as well he had no regular employment at present. In the meantime, as it would not do to have Mr. Weichman living with Anna and Miss Fitzpatrick without my presence, I packed my things. We set off on a crisp November day in a wagon, loaded only with my favorite chair, my bedstead, my clothing, and a few other necessities, as Mr. Lloyd was leasing the tavern furnished. Johnny glanced back as we left the crossroads.
Armpit of the universe, he said. I can't wait until I can leave this behind for good.
Why, you used to sigh after this place when you were in school. I remember your letters.
That was before I discovered other places, Ma.
Washington City?
New York? Montreal?
When have you been to those places?
A few months ago, for work, or what I call work anyway. I'd like to go to Europe one day. That reminds me, Ma, of something I should have asked before. Will my friends be welcome at H Street?
When have your friends ever not been welcome? Then I realized his meaning. Friends of the South? Of course, provided that they don't turn out the paying boarders. And we must be careful around Mr. Weichman and Miss Fitzpatrick.
Miss Fitzpatrick's harmless. If she gives a thought to the war, and I'm not sure she does, it's for the South. She seems to know half the Irish in Washington City. And the draft riots up in New York ought to tell you what they think of the war.
Miss Fitzpatrick is of rather a different class. But no, I don't think she troubles her head much with North or South, from what Anna writes. But Mr. Weichman, didn't you say he works for the War Department now?
Yes, but that could prove useful. I tell you, he's a Southern man at heart.
Well, you do know him very well, I suppose.
It's not just that. I've become adept at detecting such things. One has to be. Sat beside a man on the stage a few weeks back, and he tried to get me to talk secession with him. I wouldn't do it. I pretended to be a dolt who cared for nothing but horses and hunting. Later, I learned that he was a government agent. He said all of the right things, yet something about him made me doubt him all along.
A government agent?
Oh, they're always sniffing around Southern Maryland, Ma. Nothing new there.
Then I am even more glad we are leaving the tavern. Since removing Johnny from his postmaster position the year before, the government appeared to have been leaving us well alone, but one never knew. The roads were dry, so we made good time to Washington. As we turned onto H Street, I looked around me with pleasure. Washington was not a terribly attractive town, it had to be said. Pigs strolled around as freely as the humans there, and there was plenty of garbage to keep them well fed. But this was one of its better streets, and the farther into the city we drove, the more substantial and well-kept the houses appeared. As our cart pulled up by the house, Mr. Weichman appeared, carrying a handful of books. He was on the whole a good-looking young man, though his slightly chubby face spoiled the effect a little. Johnny, having kept in touch with him since having to leave school to help me with the tavern, brought him on a visit to our place a couple of years before. At the time, Mr. Weichman was thinking of entering the priesthood, though the way his eyes rested upon my stately daughter made me wonder if this was his true calling.
"What timin'?" Johnny called. "You travel light." "My trunk's already here. This is the last of my things."
Anna and Miss Fitzpatrick came out on the stairs to greet us. I'd not seen Anna look so well dressed since she left school. Her dress was newly trimmed, and she was wearing a pair of earrings that in the country she donned only for special occasions.
"Here's Ma, to save you girls from a certain ravishment at the hands of Weichman,"
Johnny called up the stairs.
"Really, Johnny?"
Anna and I chorused, while Miss Fitzpatrick giggled, and Mr. Weichman blushed. Well before election day came around, I was settled into my new lodgings. Mr. Weichman was everything one could wish for in a boarder, quiet, polite, and temperate, neither too solitary nor too social. And Miss Fitzpatrick was sweet-tempered and quite willing to lend Anna a hand with the housekeeping. I just wished I had one more of each of them. Johnny, back at the tavern tending to the crops, was a year too young to vote. But Mr. Weichman, who was 22, went to Philadelphia to cast his ballot and returned to Washington that evening. As we sat in the parlor, I thought of the last presidential election, when my husband was alive and our tavern was the local polling place. Not a single soul had cast a ballot for President Lincoln, my husband announced as he tallied the vote, a quick task and one for which he had commendably remained sober.
"Whom did you vote for, Mr. Weichman?" Anna asked.
"Now, Anna," I said, "Mr. Weichman need not tell us that." I was curious to hear the answer myself, however.
"I voted for the man I thought would serve the country best," Mr. Weichman said.
"I hope President Lincoln is defeated," Anna put in. "He's a hideous man." "Father saw him once. He said he has very kind eyes."
"Your father sees everyone, Miss Fitzpatrick."
"Indeed, he does. There's hardly a soul in Washington he doesn't know, at least by sight. But he only glimpsed the president riding to his summer place."
Miss Fitzpatrick put her chin on her hand and sighed.
"It is such a pity to live in the capital city and have to find out the election results in the morning, just as if we were in Kansas or something. I wish we could stand out by the White House and wait. If we had an escort, we could go."
This was such a naked appeal to Mr. Weichman, I could not help but smile and wonder how many such sad-eyed petitions Mr. Fitzpatrick had heard over the years. Fortunately, Mr. Weichman reacted as desired.
"I can escort you there, if you like, and Miss Surratt, too, if she wishes."
"Oh, would you please, Mr. Weichman?"
"I'll go," Anna said, "even though I won't be able to endure it if that creature wins." "Which he probably will," I warned her.
"It will be a long wait, perhaps, and it is a miserable night," Mr. Weichman added.
"We'll wrap up well," Miss Fitzpatrick promised. "Mrs. Surratt, won't you come? It will be lonely sitting here all by yourself."
Touched, I said, "I would be delighted to." So, bundled up and carrying umbrellas that knocked against one another as we made our way down the muddy street, we headed under Mr. Weichman's protection to the White House, in front of which a crowd of white and black, male and female, had already gathered. The club rooms and the hotels, Mr. Weichman told us, were the best places to await news, but they were not suitable places for ladies to linger. Even where we stood, however, news arrived regularly in the form of men, some more sober than others, who came to yell out the latest returns. Most were in favor of President Lincoln, which invariably met with a chorus of, "Huzzah!" By the fifth or sixth time, however, even Miss Fitzpatrick was so caught up in the excitement so as to cheer with the rest.
"I wish Mr. Surratt were here," she said apologetically, stamping her boots to keep her feet warm. "How sad to be away when there is so much excitement in Washington."
As the night wore on, and it became clear the president's re-election was assured, we were preparing to go home when a group of men, bearing the Pennsylvania flag, pushed their way through the crowd and began to sing.
"Yes, we'll rally round the flag, boys, we'll rally once again, shouting the battle cry of freedom. We will rally from the hillside, we'll gather from the plain, shouting the battle cry of freedom. The Union forever, hurrah, boys, hurrah! Down with the traitors, up with the stars, while we rally round the flag, boys, rally once again, shouting the battle cry of freedom."
"There is a Southern version of this song, too," Anna hissed. "Johnny taught it to me."
"For goodness sake, child, don't sing it here."
"I'll hum it," Anna decided.
When the Pennsylvanians stopped singing and Anna humming, the former began yelling for the president to appear, which presently he did. Leaning his head out the window as the crowd yelled and Miss Fitzpatrick gave a yelp of delight.
"Hideous," muttered Anna. "Oh, hush, you'll get us cast into prison," Miss Fitzpatrick said good-naturedly. "He looks kind, just as Father said. Don't you think so, Mrs. Surratt?"
"I can't make out his features," I admitted. "My vision is not like it used to be." We fell silent as the president began speaking.
"I am thankful to God for the approval of the people. But while deeply grateful for this mark of their confidence in me, if I know my heart, my gratitude is free from any taint of personal triumph. I do not impugn the motives of anyone opposed to me. It is no pleasure to me to triumph over anyone. But I give thanks to the Almighty for this evidence of the people's resolution to stand by free government and the rights of humanity."
"The rights of darkies," Anna muttered, and turned away, her nose in the air, leaving us no choice but to follow her.
"Four more years of that man," she said, as we walked home, pressing close to Mr. Wagman, as drunkards wove too close to us. "Can I bear it?"
"A lot can happen in 4 years, Miss Surratt," Mr. Wagman said.
Anna sniffed as Mr. Wagman angled his umbrella more protectively over her head.
"No need to state the obvious, sir."
4. Nora. December 1864. On Christmas Eve, we in the boarding house all had plans to go our separate ways. Mr. Wagman to take the train to Philadelphia to see his family, me to accompany my father to Baltimore to visit my sister and some family friends, the Surratts to spend Christmas at their new home without us boarders underfoot. But first, we sat down for breakfast. The men, who shared a bedroom, were the last to arrive. They had gone out last night, Mr. Wickman to buy some presents for his sisters, and Mr. Surratt to offer him his invaluable advice, as he put it, and had stayed out until past their usual hour. Mr. Surratt yawned as he sat down.
"Ma, you didn't wait up for us last night."
"Should I have? I trusted that Mr. Wackman would keep you out of trouble."
"If you had, I would have told you whom I met."
"So now you can tell all of us," Anna said.
"As I was planning to. But you must guess. Whom do you think Wackman and I met in the street?"
"The president?"
"Old Abe? Who cares? No, try again."
"Mrs. Sprague," Anna suggested, naming Kate Chase, the recently married daughter of the even more recently appointed Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, one of the most beautiful women in Washington, and now one of the richest. Her wedding to the governor of Rhode Island had been the talk of the town last year.
No, those dainty slippers would never touch the mud, although I'd much rather meet her on the street than old Abe any day. You try, Miss Fitzpatrick.
I shrugged. There were so many important people in Washington one might glimpse. John Wilkes Booth? I said idly.
Why, how did you guess?
I dropped my fork. Him?
Yes. Mr. Wackman and I were by Oddfellows Hall when we saw Dr. Mudd from Bryantown. You probably know Dr. Mudd from when you were at school there, Anna.
I do. He treated one of my classmates when she fell sick. But what's Dr. Mudd to me? I want to hear about Mr. Booth.
Well, to get to the Booth, you must step through the mud. Dr. Mudd hailed us and introduced his companion, who, if you're clever, you might deduce was Mr. Booth.
I thought his name was Mr. Boone at first,
Mr. Wackman admitted. Oh, Mr. Wackman, Anna sighed. You are such a stick. How does he look close up? I asked.
I'm not a connoisseur of men's looks, Miss Fitzpatrick, but I think most would call him very handsome. Perhaps more so in person than on stage, since there's not the gaslight or the makeup to intrude.
I gazed raptly into space. Anna leaned forward. So, what happened next? Did you continue on?
Goodness no, sister. It gets better. Mr. Booth invited the three of us to his rooms at the National Hotel, and we sat and had milk punch and smoked cigars, Anna said. I smell them on you and Mr. Wackman.
Yes, well, we men like our cigars, you know. If you wish to marry, you will have to learn to tolerate them, or else die an old maid. Anyway, we drank our milk punch, smoked our fiendish cigars, and talked a while. Afterward, we went on to Dr. Mudd's rooms at Pennsylvania House. He came to town to see some relatives and talked some more. And that is it, except that Mr. Booth has promised to call upon us here sometime.
Truly?
So he said. Mind you, he didn't say precisely when.
We shall have to keep the place spotless at all times, Ma, Anna said. Thank goodness the furniture in the parlor is new. I couldn't bear to see Mr. Booth sitting here in shabby surroundings. He travels a great deal and must stay in all sorts of places, I said. Perhaps he will be willing to make some allowances.
Nay, Miss Fitzpatrick, that will not do. We must be in readiness to receive him at any possible moment, and the house must be in a state of nearly palatial splendor.
Mr. Surratt studied his egg thoughtfully.
Perhaps we should not serve any meals here, lest the smell of cooking offend him.
Johnny, stop tormenting the young ladies,
Mrs. Surratt said. This is a perfectly respectable house. And a clean one, too, if I must say so myself. And there is no reason Mr. Booth, if he comes, should not be pleased. He will not, of course, be expecting a grand house.
Well, I might have added a staircase or two in my description of it, and a bay window. Is it too late to bring a builder over?
A few hours later, Father came for me in a hack, and we took the train to Baltimore, where my brother, Peter, was supposed to have arrived from Boston the day before. Sure enough, he was waiting at the station for us. I repressed a sigh as we stepped off the train. I loved my brother, but beside him and my father's great pride in him, I felt frivolous and insignificant, especially as I could think of nothing I was likely to do that would make Father shine the same proud look upon me. Except perhaps to marry someone very much like Peter. As we sat down to tea at our hotel, Peter pulled a journal from his valise.
The National Quarterly Review did a little piece about Holy Cross, where I was last year, and I am mentioned in it,
he said modestly, and handed it to Father. My father plucked a pair of spectacles from his pocket, accoutrements he normally used with the utmost reluctance, and began to scan the pages.
Professor Fitzpatrick has always an appropriate suggestion to make when the student seems to get confused, which scarcely ever fails to restore his presence of mind.
Why, son, you have impressed this writer very much. He was taken with the institution as a whole, not just me, Father.
Still, he singled you out for notice. I shall read the rest when I retire tonight.
I would like to read it too before you leave.
Of course. What have you been doing, Nora?
I was relieved to be able to report. I have been going to one of the hospitals and reading to the convalescent soldiers. I have so much free time on my hands, and I felt that I should be doing something to help them. My brother gave me a rare grin.
I hope you allow them something besides Charlotte Bronte, Nora. She is not to all tastes.
I do read from others, I said in an injured tone. I read Pickwick the other day. The men thought my Sam Weller was excellent.
Whatever you read to them, I am glad you are doing it,
Father said. I don't think Mrs. Surratt entirely approves, I admitted. With her sympathies, Peter, who was the only abolitionist I knew in person, snorted.
She may as well resign herself to the inevitable. The Confederacy is in its death throes, and it is high time.
Peter, my father said,
remember where you are. We are not in Massachusetts. We are in the Union, and as a Union man, I shall speak as freely as I please.
But he did add,
out of respect for you, Father, I will speak quietly while I am here in Baltimore.
I had not enjoyed seeing my father reprove my brother as much as I had expected. To lighten the mood, I said, Mr. John Surratt met a new acquaintance yesterday, and you'll never guess who. John Wilkes Booth, the actor. Both my brother and my father gratified me by turning astonished faces toward me.
Why, I would have hardly thought that Mr. Surratt traveled in theatrical circles,
Father said. He met him through Dr. Mudd, a physician in the country. Mr. Booth even invited Mr. Surratt and the other gentleman to his lodgings at the National Hotel. He might even pay a call at Mrs. Surratt's.
He may have simply said he would call, without having meant to keep his word,
Peter said gently.
A man like that surely has more fashionable company with which to occupy himself.
Nora and I saw him play last year,
Father said.
He is a marvelous actor. Have you seen him, Peter?
No, only his brother Edwin in Boston.
I should hardly say only, though, for he is as gifted an actor as I've ever seen.
I believe that John Wilkes Booth is every bit as talented as his brother, I said proprietarily. And I believe that he will not be so ungentlemanly as to make an engagement to come see Mr. Surratt at his home and not keep it.
You could well be right, Father said.
He cleared his throat.
If he does keep his word, you must be on guard that he doesn't pay you and Miss Surratt improper attentions. He is, how should I put this, a man of the world.
Oh, Father, I giggled. I won't let him seduce me. Though I was thrilled beyond description at the possibility that someone thought he might try, even if that someone was only my father. Father gave me a stern look, and I sat up straighter and sipped my tea.
I am certain she is in good hands with Mrs. Surratt,
Peter said kindly,
despite her regrettable proclivity for the Confederacy.
Having finished our tea, we returned to our rooms to prepare for Mass. I was heading into the small chamber where my bed was when Father stopped me.
I have had a letter from Mrs. Surratt about you.
I winced. I had never been in genuine trouble at school. I did not bully other students or cheat, lie, steal, or sneak out to meet young men, but I did rather like to have things my own way, and I had been known to answer back. On several occasions, my headmistresses had sent notes home, and it had been agreed at both St. Joseph's and the Visitation Academy at Frederick that I might be happier elsewhere.
What did she say?
I said in a small voice.
She said that you are a delightful companion to her and Anna, and that she could not be better pleased with having you in her house. I am proud of you, Nora. You have grown up into a fine young woman.
I blinked back tears.
Thank you, Father.
Father opened the larger of his bags.
I have something for you, besides your Christmas present. I thought you might want to wear it to church.
He handed me a soft bundle. I gasped as I untied it. Inside the wrapping was a cashmere shawl, full enough to cover my entire gown. I had shawls, of course, but none so large, so soft, or so beautiful as this one.
Father, it's wonderful.
I bought it a couple of months ago when I traveled to New York. I was saving it for a special occasion.
My father smiled and pinched my cheek.
I found one.
I arranged the heavy shawl until it hugged me from my shoulders to my ankles. But as we headed out in the chilly Baltimore night, it was not the warm shawl that made me glow from the inside out. It was my father's compliment, prompted by Mrs. Surratt's kind letter. From that night on, I would love Mrs. Surratt as I would a mother. 5. Mary, December 1864. With Mr. Wykman and Miss Fitzpatrick safely bound for their respective destinations, and Anna fussing over the cooking, I took the opportunity to catch Johnny alone. He was leaning against a partly open window, smoking a cigar. The reason, I surmised, for the open window.
Sorry, Ma, last of the day, I promise.
So, what do you think of my new acquaintance?
As I haven't met him yet, I presently think nothing about him.
Ah, come, wouldn't he make a good husband for Anna? Although she might have some competition there with Miss Fitzpatrick. I've never seen her so excited.
I'm not looking to match my daughter with an actor.
Not even a rich one? They say he makes a handsome sum. But it might be wise not to get Anna's hopes up anyway. He has his eye on a senator's daughter. You certainly did learn a lot about Mr. Booth in a short time. He's a very personable man. It was almost like meeting an old friend.
I began to wonder who was more stage-struck, the young ladies or Johnny. How did Mr. Booth meet Dr. Mudd?
The same way I did.
Johnny flicked the remnant of his cigar expertly out onto H Street and closed the window.
You mean that Mr. Booth is a Southern man? You have hit the nail on the head and pulverized it, Ma. Yes, he is, and a quite passionate one. He wants something from me in connection with that business. I'm not sure what yet. I shall find out when we meet after Christmas.
I shook my head. As much as it pained me to think it, the South was crumbling, the city of Savannah having been President Lincoln's Christmas present this year. Johnny was expending all of his youth and energy on a lost cause.
Now, Ma, don't look so glum. I know what you're thinking, and I'm going to offer you some Christmas cheer. I am employed at a salary of $50 per month. I will start work at Adams Express Company next Tuesday.
Truly, Johnny?
Truly. I wrote to offer my services with a ready hand and a willing heart. A pretty turn of phrase, I thought, and so did the agent there, for he offered me a position upon receipt of the letter.
You could not have given me a better Christmas present, Johnny. The truth was, I did not have nearly enough boarders, and had resorted to advertising for them, whereas I once hoped to acquire them strictly through the recommendations of mutual acquaintances. My very breath seemed to come easier with the news that Johnny would be bringing in a steady income. I had no doubt he would flourish in his job, for he had always done well when he applied himself. Perhaps, although the thought was a guilty one, he would even give up his clandestine activities. Surely, having to worry about one son being felled by a Yankee bullet was enough for a mother.
6. Nora, January, 1865.
The new year came in quietly, and I thought, promisingly. There was an end to the war in sight, and although I knew that end wasn't the one Mrs. Surratt and her children were hoping for, they and everyone else would surely be better off when peace prevailed. In the meantime,
I stayed busy with my convalescence. We were working through David Copperfield, and Anna occasionally lent a hand with the piano lessons at the nearby visitation school for girls. Mr. Weichman was still employed at the War Department, and Mr. Surratt seemed to enjoy his new job at Adams Express. At least, he said he had no complaints. As for Mrs. Surratt, she had a new boarder, a 10-year-old girl named Mary Apollonia Dean, who attended school nearby and who had not been happy at her previous lodgings. That was the state of affairs one evening in early January when Anna and I sat side by side on the piano bench singing a duet. I was not particularly musical. My older sister, the nun, had inherited all the family talent in this direction. But I did enjoy singing, and no one had been known to cringe when I lifted my voice in song. Anna, on the other hand, played and sang beautifully, to the point where she could have earned her living working in a music hall, had it been respectable. So she and I were happily warbling away when the parlor door opened. As Mr. Surratt was expected any moment, we paid it no mind and carried on until we finished with a great flourish.
"Bravo,"
said a voice of pure velvet.
"Well played, ladies."
Anna and I turned and found ourselves face to face with John Wilkes Booth. If I looked half as foolish as Anna, and I dare say I looked far more foolish, the two of us must have resembled a pair of gaping idiots. And how we were dressed! We weren't in curl papers, fortunately, but I had my oldest shawl flung carelessly around my shoulders, and Anna's fair hair was twisted up in a ragged knot. Neither of us would have wanted to meet a lady friend in such a condition, much less this epitome of male beauty. For Mr. Booth was every bit as splendid as I could have imagined. To my surprise, he was not tall, but of medium height. I quickly decided tallness was an overrated trait in men, especially since I myself was short. In every other aspect, however, he was even finer than he appeared in his photographs, which could be purchased at any studio in Washington. His black hair fell in soft curls, framing a face that was lit up by deep brown eyes that I, to this day, dare not demean with any further description, lest it be inadequate. His clothing, a study in black and white, was simply yet exquisitely cut and showed off his fine physique without at all seeming to do so. He was, in short, sheer perfection.
"Now that we have finished our concert, introductions are in order," Mr. Surratt said. "Mr. Booth, my mother, Mrs. Mary Surratt, and at the piano, Miss Anna Surratt, and our lodger, Miss Nora Fitzpatrick."
Mr. Surratt grinned wickedly at us.
"And last, but certainly not least, our newest lodger, Miss Mary Apollonia Dean, who is very insistent on using all three names you'll find."
"That's a very long name,"
Mr. Booth said gravely.
"It rather wears out the tongue. What say we call you Miss Apples?"
Miss Dean, who clearly had not the slightest idea who Mr. Booth was, giggled.
"That would be all right."
"Hark!"
Mr. Surratt turned at the sound of feet on the staircase.
"Here comes Weichman. You are now in the presence of the entire Surratt household."
Mr. Weichman, who generally read in his room at about this time, entered at the sound of his name.
"Mr. Booth,"
he said with an emphasis on the surname.
"How good to see you again."
Mr. Booth held out his hand.
"You are just in time, Mr. Weichman, to join my petition."
"Petition?"
"To have Miss Surratt and Miss Fitzpatrick perform another song for us. I was unfortunate enough to catch only the last few minutes of their final piece."
Anna beamed.
"We should be honored, Mr. Booth."
She riffled through some sheets of music.
"How about this, Nora?"
I nodded without even seeing the piece she indicated. We squeezed together on the bench and began to play. Anna had chosen a piece where she could shine, which was reasonable, I supposed, as she was the more talented, and the daughter of the house to boot. It was just as well, because I flubbed my first few notes before my instinct took over and allowed me to get through the rest creditably.
Beautiful,
Mr. Booth clapped.
Have either of you had professional training?
Although he had considerately addressed his question to both of us, I knew Anna was its true object. So I stayed silent as she replied,
No, indeed. Only at school.
She won several medals at school, Mrs. Surratt added proudly.
And do you sing these duets every night?
Nearly so, I said, startling myself to find my voice sounding so normal, as if I was speaking to any ordinary person.
Well, it is charming. You will think me foolish for running on so upon the point, but living as I do in hotels and associating mainly with fellow bachelors, I so seldom encounter family scenes such as this, except when I visit my own people, and they are scattered now.
I mustered the courage to make another contribution to the conversation.
I believe you have a large family, Mr. Booth.
Indeed I do. You know of my brother, Edwin, of course, and Junius is making a name for himself on the stage as well. Joseph lives out west and is carrying mail, the last I heard. Not an easy task in San Francisco, he tells me. I confess to being closer to my sisters than my brothers. Asia is the prettiest and the most outgoing. She is the most like me, they say. Rosalie is rather shy, but a very good sort of girl. She is the best of all of us. And, of course, there is our mother. She makes her home with Edwin now.
Does she have a favorite, Mr. Booth?
Anna asked archly.
Anna,
Mrs. Surratt said, more amused than reproving.
No mother admits to such things.
No, she does not mention it, as you say, Mrs. Surratt, but I believe my brothers and sisters, if pressed, would say that I was the favorite.
Mr. Booth bestowed a smile upon us.
They would probably be right, I fear, for I certainly was the most petted growing up, I believe. I could hardly be expected to object, though.
We laughed.
But enough about me. Your son tells me, Mrs. Surratt, that he has a brother fighting for the South.
I have not heard anything about him, good or ill, for several years,
Mrs. Surratt said sadly.
I hope you will hear good of him, and soon. And you, Miss Fitzpatrick, do you have kinsmen fighting?
I felt myself flush with pleasure. Men seldom remembered my name, or at best, remembered it only partially, and called me Miss Fitzgerald. Some of the patients at the hospital, even one who rather liked me, still called me by the latter name. With all the misery they had seen, it seemed petty to correct them.
Not close ones, sir. My father is employed by a bank here in town, and my brother teaches. He wants to become a priest.
Miss Fitzpatrick's sister is a nun, added Anna, rather too precipitously.
Do you have plans to enter a convent?
I put my chin up.
Certainly not.
Well, good,
Mr. Booth said.
I have every respect for those good women, but it is a life that one should enter only if one embraces it wholeheartedly, I should think.
He turned to Miss Dean.
You, Miss Apples?
Only some cousins, Miss Dean said, and I don't like them anyway.
Well, that is a comfortable way of looking at it,
Mr. Booth said. He grinned, showing teeth I need hardly say were perfect, and turned his attention to Mrs. Surratt.
Mrs. Surratt, I have been enjoying the company of your son very much over the last few weeks. I sought an introduction to him in the purely selfish hope that he could smooth out a business transaction for me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.